Darren Phillippe here with Realtor Roundtable. Thank you very much for tuning in and checking out another podcast of mine. We have a special guest here. We've got Kevin Kauffman here from Arizona, and I have him on the line. We were trying to get together in Texas a few weeks ago, but we just could not make it. So we said, hey, there's this little thing called Skype that we could get on the phone and talk a little bit. So, Kevin, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. How about yourself?
I'm doing very well. Thank you so much for taking this time to talk to me. I've been really looking forward to talking to you. One thing that I love to do is spending time kind of picking the brain with of agents that kind of are figuring out how to do specific things. And I spoke to one of my friends who has also figured out a few things. And said that you would be a great person for me to speak with. So, Kevin, why don't you tell me a little bit about you and a little bit about your background and go from there?
Yeah, well, I operated a team with my business partner, Fred Weaver, in out of the Tempe, Arizona Market Center in Tempe. We call ourselves Group 4610. That's our team name. And we operate out of Keller Williams, Arizona Realty in Tempe, as I was saying. I have been in real estate. I got my license in the middle of 07, and if you know anything about the Arizona real estate market, that was the perfect time. As prices were plummeting and inventory was skyrocketing, all my friends told me I was absolutely insane for getting into real estate, which, being the type of guy I am, actually did nothing but confirm the fact in my head I was making the right decision. So I got in at a very fun time. In fact, I did a couple transactions. I had a really good friend that bought a home and had another, referral, sold a home. And then my third transaction I run into was a short sale. And I have just been kind of cut my teeth on short sales. I've been doing them ever since. I love short sales. I almost prefer them over regular, quote-unquote, regular transaction. And I've just been really fortunate that I'm to grow my business because I was willing to do something that most, and so, we kind of started, this partner and I, we got together just after I got my license. We started working together February of 08, and it was because we were both doing short sales. We were both doing them, working from home, and it wasn't fun to call the banks from home by yourself, and we'd both been employing, actually his little brother worked for us individually part-time as sort of a listing assistant. And so we just started talking one day, and we thought, hey, what would this look like if we sat in the same office and we helped each other out, and I made some phone calls for you, you made some phone calls, and you know what? One thing led to another. 600-700 short sale transactions later, here we are in 2013, and we built a nice little business out of it.
What a story. That's awesome. I too got into the business in 06, 07. Actually, I got in the business in 06. And purchased my home at the peak of the market in 07. I couldn't have bought it at a better time. At 2007 of February, we closed on our house of $260,000. And I believe today it's going for about $97,000. And I know
so it's doubled in value than last month is what you're telling me.
Yeah, nobody's better at buying real estate than me. Well, very cool. Now, what were you doing before you got into real estate?
I try not to talk about that, except for with my therapist. believe it or not, I like to say I worked on the other side. I worked for banks. I've been in banking most of my adult life, from about the age of, 19 or 20 forward. I've worked for banks, actually, in one form or another. When I moved to Phoenix in 98, I have in the collections department for Bank One, in the credit, very soft collection type environment. And then I kind of moved up and got more of a support role and a technical role. But I stayed in a collections environment for the next, it was about 8.5 years or so until I finally decided I could no longer take it. I couldn't work for the big bad bank any longer. And I couldn't be controlled by the man, so to speak. And so it's actually what I did leading up to real estate, believe it or not.
Wow, that's pretty cool. Has that helped you going through the whole short sale process? And, I mean, you said you've only closed about 600-700 short sales over the last 5 years or so. Has that helped you, having the understanding on the bank side of things, kind of approach them the other way?
Yeah, you know, it did. It helped me on multiple levels. And one of the ways, I'll tell you, really helped me at first is I understood who I was dealing with. So as I was calling these people, you know, who for banks, the bank employees, and, you know, I'm talking to them about, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars. And these are folks that I know are making $10 and $15. I know the environment work, and it's not a fun environment. So it helped me to relate to them, to understand. It didn't mean I didn't any less mad with the way I was treated,
sure,
or any less mad with the way they for their apathy and the way they handle things in a lot of cases. But I understood where they're coming from, and I knew when I was being lied to. I knew what was going on because I'd been there, worked in that environment for so long. Mm. So that helped me, but also really understanding the way a financial institution looks at making decisions, I understood that it really wasn't about hardships. It wasn't about the bank wanting to help my client. It was about the bottom line, and I knew it. And I understand reserves, you know, part of, you know, in the banking world, and I don't bore anybody, but I know that when a company, a credit card company or a mortgage company has got a loan out and it becomes delinquent, they not only are not receiving payments on their, you know, they're in the business of receiving interest payments. And so not only are they not receiving the interest payments on the money they've lent you, they're no longer receiving interest payments on money that they've now had to put in reserves to cover that potential loss. Mm. And so as you fall further and further delinquent, whether it be a mortgage or a credit card, that institution actually has to take money aside and put it into the reserve account, meaning they can't lend that money out either, which so you're really hampering them from being able to run their business model. And so I always told people, I always told my clients, look, it's not your hardship that matters. The minute you stop making your payments, the bank has a hardship. The investor of that loan is the one with the hardship, and that's what we're going to pay on.
Wow. Wow. There's no doubt. Jeez. Yeah, being able to understand, I guess, the competition, and as horrible as that sounds, it really is. I mean, my guess is the banks, it's not a personal thing. It's not a personal attack to you and your clients. It's strictly a numbers and a business game. And so to be able to understand what they have to go through, I can only imagine makes your job so much easier.
Yeah, and, you know, it's fun because I always said short sales are kind of like putting a puzzle together. Because the reality is the person you're dealing with in the front lines don't understand. They have no idea what reserves are. They don't understand that it's about the bottom line. They're checking to make sure the I's are dotted and the T's are crossed, a hardship letter, things like that. And so they don't get that. They don't understand why decisions are made. But the decision maker, if you will, does understand that. And that's all that they really care about. And so it's funny because you have to navigate in short sales. You've got to navigate around kind of that frontline person who really does understand why decisions are made, but has a process they have to go through. And you really ultimately end up getting to a decision maker that could care less about a hardship.
Right.
When it comes down to the decision maker, it's all about the, you know, financial bottom line for that institution.
Wow. But now tell me this. There's many of my listeners, they're across the country. In fact, they're even out of the country too. So short sales may have not hit them as hard. And so with in Vegas and Arizona, we have similar markets where short sales have really been kind of taken over our market. First, you do all of the negotiating yourself. Is that correct?
Yeah, we handle it 100% in-house. We'd never would outsource that. And part of that, you know, especially if part of this is because it's a control thing, and I know that I'm going to take care of my clients better than anybody else will. And I got to tell you, it's really easy. Agents all over the country for years, everybody likes to tell me about this new third-party company they're working with, this new law firm or this new agent that's going to negotiate their short sales for them for, you know, it should be just half the commission. Then it became like a flat fee, and then it was like only a couple $100s. And yeah, it's always a perfect world scenario. And, you know, I always laugh because I've never heard one success story. No, never heard one long-term success story. It's always great at the beginning. And then my question would be, well, how many have they closed for you now? And it's, you know, we're just starting. And then, you know, invariably it was up because nobody can take care of your client the way you can take care of your client. And
right.
So if you're in a market that hasn't been hit yet and is, you know, it's becoming more and more prevalent, Seattle is seeing more and more short sales. Philadelphia is seeing more and more short sales. If you're in an area like that where the wave is actually just now hitting you, make a decision to be in or out of short sales. because you don't want to practice and hurt your client. Their financial future is in your hands when you agree to list their short sale. And I think it's horrible. You know, the industry average is like 30 or 40% success rate. I think that's awful. People want to blame the banks. I blame the agents for not understanding short sales at a high level.
Sure.
And I just feel you should either do it or you should choose not to do it and refer them all out to an expert.
Right.
But either become an expert or refer to an expert. Don't kind of, you know, try to have one foot on each side of the fence.
Excellent, excellent. And that's perfect. That goes to my next question is there's agents that are just, you know, taking on short sales and they're definitely time consuming because it takes a while and you got to do a lot of follow up and there's a lot of I's and that need to be dotted and T's that need to be crossed. And there gets to a point where it's like, hey, this is eating up a lot of my life. First of all, how many transactions were you able to do last year? And then number two, how are you able to handle that volume and to balance your business out a little bit?
Absolutely. Well, you know, you're right. Actually, if you don't mind, I'd like to go backwards first and talk about 2008 before I tell you about 2012. Because you're right, there's a time investment into short sales. And I'll give you an example. Fred and I had worked together that year. Our first year started in February. We hired somebody in July of that year, our first full-time employee. We had his brother help, but you know, he wasn't full-time for us. We finally made our first hire, you will, to use the MREAA verbiage, and we closed 60 short sales in 2008, full year in real estate, and 40 of those occurred in the fourth quarter. So when you look at that, there's a lag time because short sales take longer. Now, they don't take as long today,
right?
And especially not compared to 2008, but we closed 60 deals. I was broken in August, and we always joke. Fred and I went to Mega Agent Camp that year. It was the first time we'd ever gone to a national KW event, and I mean, we were broke. We made $250 that month combined. Now, if you look at our GCI for that year, it was very nice. We both did very well that year. You know, combined, we'd done about 450 or so, maybe even 500. But all that money came in the fourth quarter because there's such a lag time with short sales. At that point, it was like 6 months before you
right.
get paid. So it's a lot quicker today. But the point is that there is a lag time. There's a time investment. We realize that if we just fill this pipeline and do the activities that we know are going to produce results, it would produce results. So fast forward to 2012, you know, as a team, and we've evolved as a team. It's not like we only do short sales. We're a full-service real estate team. You know, we closed 219 transactions in total in 2012. Of that, about 155 of those were listings, and of those listings, 130 of those, maybe more like 125 of those were short sales.
Wow. That, you know, Kevin, that those numbers are pretty crazy numbers. No, I mean, knowing how hard an agent works to do short sales, let alone just do 200 plus transactions, that is an unbelievable number, and I can only imagine that you have got to be Mr. Systems guy and Mr. Follow-up guy to be able to handle that volume. Is that correct?
Yeah, well, I'm lucky. My business partner is Mr. Systems guy. I am Mr. Impatient Hard Driver, though.
Oh, okay.
And he's a driver, but also very much a systems person. So, yeah, that is the key. We have phenomenal systems. I would put I'm not saying this to brag. I would put our system up against any system in the entire world that anybody has. And, you know, there's one or two people out there that have done more short than we have. But I know that our systems are better. We really have a better process and a better system for handling. If we did that, Warren, it would be easier on us. And so we started building the systems from almost day one that would help us get to where we wanted to go.
Gotcha. Now open up, if you wouldn't mind, if you can kind of share with us some of your key systems or key parts of your system. I know there's very specific things that really will help an agent that's trying to figure out how to do the whole short sale process. If you could share a couple of those with us, that would be awesome.
Yeah, I'll tell you the first kind of system. This is going to sound obvious, but it wasn't obvious to us till about a couple months in. We realized we built so much momentum once we started working together, and we're getting all these leads. And you know, we went from the day we started working together, we had 12 listings combined. We were up to 50 within, it seemed like overnight, probably 3 to 4 months. I mean, it was quick. And what we realized is we were wasting time, quote unquote, wasting time on the phone with people would call and they have questions, and the reality is those conversations were all taking an hour. And so we very quickly built the website. The first version of our website was designed to just be an informational landing page for people considering short sales. And so the very first system we put in place was, how do we handle a new lead? And what we did is we put together all the Q&As that we knew to be true based on our own experience, because there's a lot of bad information out there on short sales.
Right.
And so we said, let's talk about what we've personally experienced and what are the questions we get. So we built a website that had those Q&A. Our next step to that was, we then built a form on our website that a client could fill out to give us more information and allow them to download our short sale package. So we'd essentially say, you give us information, we'll give you the short sale package that we need from you anyways.
Awesome.
So really, before we would do anything with a lead, we gave them questions, fill out the request form, start working on your paperwork, and then we can have an in-person consultation or a phone consultation.
Would you say that you would prep them with mostly the questions that they're going to be already asking and the information they're already going to be asking? You're providing that information up front before you even meet with them. Is that correct?
Yeah, and the reason was, it was for us at first, it was a time saver. We just had to do it. And then we realized it was just the best way to handle, because not everybody, you know, the thought process that a short sale seller goes through, they all move on different timelines. And so we just knew we could save time and we could make it more efficient. So we gave them the frequently asked questions that we knew would come up.
Right.
And then we gave them the homework of filling out this form to download our short sale package. That way, when we did meet with them, we could have a higher level conversation with them.
Awesome. That's great. I love that. I'm a big kind of a tech geek now, and I'm all about, if somebody's asking me the same question over and over and over again, and it's going to be taking a lot of time, I'm going to create a video. I'm going to create some sort of process or system that can leverage myself, you know, leverage, you know, that time that I could be and hopefully kind of cut, you know, free up myself, and so I can go and do other things. And so I love that, dude. You got to do that in short sales.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, it helps regardless, just have kind of defining your process. That way you know what to do. When the lead comes in, this is you do this and you do it every single time. There's never wondering what you do. We also didn't have to worry about, wait, did I forget to tell them about taxes? Did I forget to tell them about credit? Or did I tell one person one thing, but I told somebody else it's slightly different? It's in writing or it's on video, and it happens the same way every single time.
Kevin, what website would be a great example of kind of what you're doing?
Yeah, group3610.com. So it's just www.group4610.com. And then just click on the short sale page. There's an FAQ page, and there is a short sale request form. You can take a look at that. That's still to this day what we use.
That is awesome. I love that, dude. Well, cool. What other system do you believe is key when it comes to having a smooth process in your short sale?
Yeah, you know, the next big system that we got, and we still use it today, and it may be outdated, but it works so well for us that I just can't imagine it going away from it, is we purchased the broker version of SureClose, the transaction management system, and we got it. And the reason why we purchased it is because the broker version, it cost us a couple $1,000s at the time, but we could customize it. And so we made this system to work basically our process flow for short sales. So we've got all these templates in there. When I use the SureClose system, it tells me, hey, on day one you do this, and then when this happens, you do this. And then as soon as you press this button, it pops up the next task, and it tells you, hey, this is due in 3 days. I mean, it is just literally our entire process flow, steps 1 through 200 of everything that we do in a short sale. And it allows us to not only make sure we don't miss on our process, but to communicate with everybody. So our sellers get a login to the system. The buyer's agents get a login to the system. Our escrow company gets a login to the system. And we can communicate with them all. We record every single thing that happens in the transaction in the system. All emails get recorded in there. Notes from all phone calls get recorded in there. I mean, it has got everything that we use in this system. And that's allowed us to communicate effectively, have everything all in one place, and just really handle volume. So it's really cool if you're coming in for the day and you're going, well, what files do I have to work on? you don't really have to worry about it. You can we can log in and just see what tasks we have to do today.
Well, you know, Kevin, I listening to kind of you explain your I guess platform that you're running your whole short sale process through. What you're doing is you're providing your clients a very systematic process where they're going to be able to get a positive, you know, experience every single time they're working with you. And I can only imagine that has got to be a huge tool for you to be able to capture referrals from people that you were able to close short sales on. Has that helped you quite a bit?
Oh, absolutely. I got to tell you, still to this day, referrals from clients and past clients is our number one source of business. And until the last 4 months, we've been horrible at keeping in touch with our database. We've gotten a lot better at it and a lot more purposeful about it. But even with that, we get a ton of referrals. I mean, we did 219 transactions last year. The overwhelming majority of those transactions were referrals from past or present clients.
So tell me this then. If I'm an agent that knows that referrals are key and that's kind of where I get my business, but I'm not very good at using my database, like you were saying, hey, I haven't really done it to really the level you're doing now. What key things were you able to do to really make that switch to kind of make it more purposeful?
You know, what we did is we moved our CRM to we had Top Producer. We were on Top Producer for years, and we moved over to a new system called Infusionsoft. It's actually not new, but it's not designed for real estate either. And it's a very, very, very powerful tool. I kind of feel like I'm driving a Ferrari, except I'm only doing about 10 miles an hour still.
Sure.
And, you know, it's just helped us to get clear. It gave us the opportunity to clean up our database. So I've literally spent from October until, you know, up until last week, believe it or not, touching every single one of our past clients and making sure that they're on the appropriate follow-up plan and they're getting personal emails, not just the canned, you know, emails and our video newsletters that go out monthly, but personal written emails, you know, hey, Darren, how's everything going? How's the wife? How's the dog? How's the kids? Things like that. Touching base with people, letting them know how much we appreciate them. I literally personally went through all of our past clients and did that. And they're all set up for, you know, future phone calls, personal emails, handwriting notes throughout the years now. And so, you know, the switch to Infusionsoft, maybe it wasn't necessary to do that, but what it did is it created the opportunity to, and that by necessity, to dig through each one of them individually.
Yeah.
And it's been great. It's been great.
Yeah, you know, I totally agree. And I think your statement of, was it necessary for you to go from Top Producer to, you said Infusionsoft?
Correct.
Yeah, going through exercises like this require you to kind of organize things and systemize things and kind of fix things that you might have been, you know, needing to do in the past, and it says, fine, I'm going to go ahead and do it. Have you noticed already a difference in your communication with your clients and the referrals that you're currently getting now?
Yeah, you know what, the thing I've noticed is it never stops. The referrals never stop. I was at home the other night, and I was, it was 4:30. I had to go home early, and I've got a new baby, and she had her four-month checkup, and so I was at home after that. And my phone literally rang straight for about 35 minutes, and three of the four phone calls were referrals. They were, hey, so-and-so told me you can help me out with the short sale. So-and-so told me you can help me buy a home. And it was just, I was just going, the power of this is amazing. And it's funny, it's not even necessarily some of the people that I've spoken to recently. It's just that we're doing so many of the activities that the database is just continuing to feed us. And we know that, you know, it's the activities that count. You measure the activities, the results will be there. And so we're doing the activities that are required, that we believe are required for the results we want to get. And we're seeing it. It's coming true.
I think what you just said is key across the board in real estate. If you're doing the key activities, you will get results. And many agents, I believe, are frustrated because they're not making the money they want to. They're not getting the results that they want to. And then when we ask, you know, me as a coach, I ask them, well, what kind of activities are you doing? The activities that they're doing are matching up with their result. And so, again, if you want a different result, you have to take massive action. I love that. Well, Kevin, tell me this, because I know you got to go here in a little bit. If you could share, let's stay on this topic because we've covered short sales the whole time. If you can give advice to an agent, I'd like two things. Number one, give advice to an agent that's just starting to get involved into short sales. So go ahead and cover that, and then I'll cover number two.
Okay, so you know, if you're just getting into short sales, number one is kind of what I said earlier. I can't bring it home enough. Decide to either get in or get out. And I got to tell you, I had an agent in 2008. I literally sent him $30,000 in referral fees in about 6 months, literally. So he was out of short sales, yet he was profiting from them on a big level. So get in or get out. If you're going to get in, get your hands dirty. Roll your sleeves up. Don't take no for an answer. Get the training that you need, and you just have to never take no for an answer. If you don't have that mindset, you will not be successful at short sales, period, end of story. So you've got to be willing to get your hands dirty and do what it takes. You've got to be willing to make some enemies, not on purpose, but you're going to make enemies because you're going to argue with people and you're going to make people upset. But if you're willing to do that for your client, it will shine through, and it will pay you back time and time again if you're willing to do that.
Awesome. And then the second thing that I'd love to have you, since you kind of do have the inside scoop on how the banks think and how they act and all that kind of stuff, if you could share with our listeners, really maybe a little advice on how to communicate with negotiators better and something that'll help them close their short sale faster.
Gotcha. Yeah, no problem. Well, I think the number one thing is understand that they are just people and they work in a really tough environment. I mean, I got to tell you, working on the inside of a call center is not an enviable position. It is tough. It's a hard environment. There's a reason why 3/4 of them sound pissed off when you call them, and it's because they are. They work in a bad environment. They work for a company that takes advantage of them and treats them, you know, like a number, and that's just tough to work in. So understand that. That being said, you're hired by your client, and your fiduciary responsibility is to help them avoid foreclosure, and so you've got to be willing to do what it takes. And so I guess I can sum it up by saying this way: never take no from somebody who is not in a position to give you a yes. So understand that these processors, these quote-unquote negotiators, as we like to call them, they have no authority. They have zero authority whatsoever. They act like they do, but they have no authority. So understanding that they have no authority to say yes, why would you ever accept their no?
Awesome. I'm going to leave with that. I love that. Kevin Kauffman, you've been fantastic. I think people are going to love this podcast, love this interview. Is there a way anybody can either follow you on Twitter or contact you if they wanted to speak to you a little bit more?
Yeah, absolutely. So I'll tell you, we didn't get to go into this, but we started a blog in 2009 called Short Sale Power Hour. It's since it kind of merged and become, it's just kevinandfred.com. It's really original, kevinandfred.com. We used to record video once a day, 5 days a week. Now we do once a week. Used to almost be all short sale training, but there's literally, I don't know, 600-700 videos on there for free short sale video training that you can just log in and register.
Wow.
Our Twitter feeds are on there. You could find me at twitter.com, .com/KevinKauffman, and then the number 9. So you can find me on Twitter or find me on Facebook. But yeah, absolutely. That's, you know, kevinandfred.com is probably the best place. And there's a ton of free information on there. We sell some short sale training products. Like, I mentioned SureClose earlier. A lot of people buy SureClose and then they look at it and they get confused by it. So if you buy, we have a package that we call the Crush It package, which is kind of everything that we know. It's our whole process in a box. If you buy that, if you own that and you purchase SureClose, we'll give SureClose the permission to give that person our templates so they can work from the exact same system that we work from. So take a look at kevinandfred.com, and if there's any questions, there's a pretty easy contact me button on there.
Ah, Kevin, I love that, and my guess is we might need to get Kevin and Fred on this podcast next time if you'd ever be open to it. Does that sound good?
Absolutely, we could definitely get us both on there. We'll typically talk over each other, so you may need to do it in sessions and then merge it together, but we can make that happen.
Cool. Well, Kevin, thank you so much for your time. I can't thank you enough. And for all my listeners, Realtor Roundtable, go out there and take action today.